policy context, it says that although there's no provision for the proposed development in UGP policy GB2, the NPPF includes in most appropriate development completely relevant to previously developed sites brownfield, which it isn't, whether redundant or in continually used excluding temporary buildings. It would not have a greater impact on the openness of the green belt and the purpose of including land within it than the existing development. And it goes on to say in appearance and immunity issues, the existing building is unlisted, it's not a particularly attractive building, its form use is considered to fall within the definition of previously developed land. The placement building has a smaller footprint and a slightly lower eaves height. It says the desired design is simple, will be constructed in materials to reflect the existing building. And it goes on to say about the U-Haul Farm boundary tree, which is proposed to differentiate between the two and thus the waterfalls and put those leaves to be removed. So my conclusion in this is that it's there's an existing dwelling with another building which can be used for development. And it's not impacting whether the rebuild is already in situ.
Did you want to clarify from there what the brownfield site?
It's not brownfield, but it can be used.
It's previously developed land.
Yes.
Yes.
David.
Thank you, Chair. Just very briefly, we're not talking about trying to build a dwelling in the middle of a large ploughed field with cows milling around. What we're talking about is an existing building that has no enhancement to it at all. It isn't a very nice building. And what we're trying to do is replace it with something that is clearly going to be better. I don't think, in this occasion, I'm a great, great supporter of defending the green belt at all costs, as everybody who knows me will know. But in this instance, I do not think it's going to cause an incursion into the green belt in any way. It's merely replacing a dilapidated building with something that has a beneficial use and will look a lot better than what is there. So, in all fairness, I'm inclined to support the officer's recommendation on this occasion. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, David.
Can I just ask, is it on the same footprint?
Slight smaller footprint. Yes. The original footprint measures 15.5 metres by 11.5 metres and proposes 13.7994. It is,
Steve?
Oh, sorry. I thought everyone had finished speaking. I was just about to move, sort of sensing the comments that were made. I was about to move through someone else
wants to speak. Well, I was only going to say that, Cathy,
can you tell me my
answer? I was just going to say that, whilst we all want to spend the week, but sometimes the common sense has prevailed. And for me, the acid test is whether something has been used as previously developed land.
Thank you, Cathy. Ron? You want to move? No, I'm sorry, Steve. I don't want my argument. Okay, I would move the
officer's recommendation. Okay, Steve has moved. Do we have a second up? Okay. Cathy will second that. All those in favour of approval subject to the conditions listed? That's unanimous, that's carried. Thank you very much. We're now going to move to agenda item 5, land adjacent to 168 Golden Road East, which is pages 17 to 22 of your pack, please. When you're ready, you can have a presentation.
This application is for Convention Land Apartments on an area of grass located towards the end of Bolton Road East. The site directly adjoins residential properties but is designated as a primary industrial area. Both residential developments therefore a departure from the UDP, which requires material planning considerations to outweigh. The NPPF provides that if there is no reasonable prospect of the site being used with a designated purpose, then LPAs should have regard to the market signals and relative to the needs of different land uses. In order to support a sustainable community. Policy CS17, the emerging core strategy and local plan, and asked for alternative uses to consider where, amongst other issues, there have been marketing with the site for employment purposes. There is no reasonable prospect of the site being reused for employment purposes. The site and the adjacent site have been marked as in the past industrial purposes with no interest of managing. The work on appointment on the premises study concludes that the application site and the surrounding area that regeneration of alternative use will not have serious consequences to rural economy or property market. There have been a number of other residential developments on nearby industrial sites. No problem, it's accepted that the use of the site for residential purposes will be more in keeping with the changing character of the area. In terms of appearance and community issues, the proposed building has been reduced in scale from the original plan, with the top floor now being incorporated mostly in the roof space. This reduces the bulk and visual impact of the proposal and shows that it's more in keeping with the character of the surrounding area. There are examples of two-story properties with front dormers in the area. The scale of the proposal will therefore not appear out of keeping. The design of the proposed building is considered to have sufficient character and interest to ensure that it will be a suitable addition to the street scene. The proposed building will be set away from the adjacent property by sufficient distance and separation distance of the property's opposite will exceed 21 metres. It's therefore considered that the proposal will not have an adverse impact on the amenities of existing properties. The proposed development will provide 9 street parking spaces to the rear together with areas of landscaping and crowded amenity space. Given the fairly substantial scale of the site, the provision of 9 units of parking and amenity space. It's considered to be a good use of the site and not appear as an overdraft or grant scheme. On balance, the application is therefore recommended for approval, subject to conditions. And just a couple of minor amendments to the conditions. So for condition 4, we're proposing to add in, within the bracket, we've all proposed boundary treatment and future maintenance arrangements for the site. After condition 9, to add in the storage and disposal of refuse and to include the plumbing recycling facilities.
Thank you. Thank you. We don't have a board council here present, so I'll let it go to committee. Steve?
Yeah, Chair. I think it's actually quite a reasonable development. I know we have this debate in Bromborough about some of the larger sites where we take them to leisure use or take them out of the industrial sort of availability, but you actually look at the map, it sort of nicely rounds off the residential area and then borders what is clearly all industrial use. So in my point of view, it's a very good use of a piece of land, provide much needed residencies, apartments are popular. I see no reasonable reason for objection, and unless it comes to a massive debate, I'd be happy to move approval at this point.
David wants to speak, so I'll go to David first.
Yeah. Just a very quick one, really, Chair. Could we just have a look at the elevation so we get a feeling of what it's adjacent to and what it's going to look like? The impression I got was that it's very similar in size to the shape and shape of the properties next door, and therefore it's going to be totally in character with what's going on. But I think it would be worthwhile for the committee to see what it is actually going to look like adjacent to the properties that already exist there. Thank you, Chair.
Okay, thank you, David. Pat?
Yeah, thank you, Chair. Just a couple of comments on sort of the conditions. Condition 6 is on cycle storage, and I just want to make a point that it's over 3 years now since Council voted unanimously to request that the Planning Department work with developers to ensure that plans for cycle storage are included as part of plans when they're submitted. But I see no evidence whatsoever that that is actually happening. We just continuously resort to inserting this condition on planning applications, particularly in respect to purpose-built plans. I would just really make a plea to the planning officers to actually respect what council has asked them to do and actually work with developers to get that sorted out and not have to, you know, we all know the issues we've got with planning enforcement within the authority, so it raises clear concerns about whether or not these conditions will actually be implemented in practice. And just the reword on condition 9, could I just make a suggestion that for purpose-built blocks of flats, for future applications, that we incorporate that rewording as standard so that we automatically condition the provision of recycling facilities.
Okay, do you think the officers want to come back on any of those points?
No, just agree.
Agree with you? Okay. All right then, is the Steve, you want to move that?
Yes, I will formally move it, thank you.
Okay, thank you. And seconded by George Davis. Okay, all those in favour of approval, subject to conditions listed on the amendments verbally. That's unanimous, that's carried, thank you very much. If we can now move to agenda item 9, which is pages 53 to 72 in your packs, please. This item seeks to bring to members' attention planning applications decided under delegated powers between the 20th of May 2018 and the 11th of June 2018. Are we happy to look at those or are there any comments?
Happy to thank you, Chair.
Okay, thank you very much. Moving on to agenda item 10, which is page 73 of the packs, 73 to 84. We have been asked here that the recommendation is that the Planning Committee supports the Standards and Constitutional Oversight Committee in recommending to Council that the Model Planning Code appended to this report is adopted and included within the Council Constitution. Are we happy to accept that?
Yes,
would the Director like to give any comments on this?
No, the Director's quite happy to sit down and shut up. There's no one on the questions then.
Okay, do members have any questions for the Director?
No.
Sure, can I just ask one question? I actually have on the Standards Committee that approved this, so do I have to declare any questions? Because I was on it.
No.
No, that's okay, then, thank you. Okay, so if there aren't any questions, thank you for attending, but there aren't any questions for you.
Thank you. Oh, all my tasks are just so easy now.
Yeah. Okay, we have the judicial review update of the standard agenda item. I'm just going to ask the solicitor if there are any updates, please.
Well, there's no further comment or addition that I can bring to the committee. Committee members will have received a copy of the judgment thing under cover of an email on the 11th of June, together with the Council Solicitor's chronology or timeline, which is a definitive version that members should refer to if they have any queries regarding this particular matter.
Stuart?
Thank you, Chair.
Thank you.
Last meeting, we heard that planning officers were going to write to the applicant to ask them if they had any further comments to make, given the planning report that was prepared previously. Now that the decision linked to that planning report has been squashed, have we written to the applicant requesting any further information that they may wish to get, and what deadline have we set the applicant for responding to that request for information. I'm just wondering when we can expect to receive the 2010 application for determination.
Well, the problem with the mentality is that the letter has gone out. Obviously, as part of previous debate in relation to this matter, it will be a regular review regarding progress, but clearly part of that when the enforcement proceedings are going to be wary about what is said in committee, in public as it were, but certainly there will be a regular review in relation to that, but in consideration then be given the information that we've received and have received. We haven't yet received any information, but obviously consideration will be given to anyone we receive. A reasonable period of time has been given for them to respond.
If I may press on, reasonable length of time, again, we had this discussion about 12 months ago, and officers considered something like 8 to 10 months, a reasonable length of time, which members disagreed with. So what did we say in the letter? What deadline did we give them? Because, you know, it's from our point of view now, it's an application that was first submitted in 2010. So it's about 8 years overdue determination. So what deadline have we set? And if we haven't set a specific one, it's still good to know how the applicants knows when they ought to, representations. What is the officer's definition of a reasonable length of time?
Obviously, that matter has been related to and referred to and dealt with by Ms. Wraith, who's obviously not here today. I haven't seen a copy of that particular letter, so I can't really comment further on the timeline given regarding the issue.
Can I ask that we actually get an email to members to just verify that point, then that we have that information available, please? Is that okay? Okay, Kathy.
I think at the last judicial review update, Dean asked the question that if the previous application had been quashed, so the planning application doesn't stand, that markings of an existence without planning permission is important taking place. Because how long would it go on if there's no determined application before the enforcement to do something?
Because there's no application in place, the marquees are operating immediately, aren't they? Okay, I believe Philip Paul wants to speak on this, so. I can do. Obviously, I've been involved in this from the beginning, and I've been fully a part of the process and the negotiations. There is a limit to what we'll say, because obviously we're still in public session, and some of this would be exempt advice. However, the position is that, just as you say, the permission's been quashed, but the decision is as though there was never any permission, and this is therefore one authorised development. There is therefore a process with those people from the council to say, actually, what we want from you, we will encourage you to make an application. Their desire is that nothing happens now, because they are saying they are submitting an appeal. That will be a lengthy process, so there is now a wait of several months before their application for appeal is fully heard, and then goes on to full court proceedings. The worry from our side, and the reason why we went back and said, that's not acceptable to us, and we're not willing to stay the process of demanding an application come forward, is because there is the potential of a claim from them that this gets delayed and delayed and delayed to such a point that they then say, actually, this has gone past our limitations to be able to take enforcement proceedings. So our advice has been to continue to encourage there to be an application, but at some point, and we're not on quite the same timetable that we might be with other people, but we are on the timetable where we would get to a point where actually there is no viable application in front of you, therefore we would begin enforcement proceedings before go through that process, but then stay those proceedings once they've been lodged to wait for that appeal to come through. So we are in that position now of writing to them and saying, well, the game's in your hands really, you can forward an application and go through that process, or you can do nothing and allow us to take enforcement proceedings. But the paper will come to you in due course to say what we've got back from them and what I recommend in the approach.
Okay, thank you for that. I haven't been made aware of any other urgent business.